Am on? There we are. Okay. I have to be careful. Every time I get behind a microphone, I want to do an auction, so. All right. Before I begin my message tonight, I want to thank Brother Paul Brock for standing in for me tomorrow at the Forest Grove. Thank you, Paul. Be praying for him as he goes down there. All right, I want to start off tonight with an old-fashioned lady. My friend is rather an old-fashioned lady, always quiet, delicate, and elegant, especially in language. She and her husband were planning a week's vacation in Florida, so she wrote to a campground and asked for reservations. She wanted to make sure the campground was fully equipped, but didn't know how to ask about the toilet facilities. She just could not bring herself to write the word toilet in her letter. After much deliberation, she finally came up with the term bathroom commode. But after writing that down, she still thought she was being too forward, so she rewrote the entire letter and referred to the bathroom commode merely as the BC. Does the campground have its own BC, is what she actually wrote. Well, the campground owner wasn't old-fashioned at all, and when he got the letter, he just couldn't figure out what the woman was talking about. That BC business really stumped him. After worrying about it for a while, he showed the letter to several couples, but they couldn't imagine what the lady meant either. So the campground owner finally came to the conclusion that the lady must be asking about the location of the local Baptist church. So he sat down and wrote the following reply. Dear Madam, I regret the delay in answering your letter, but I now take the pleasure of informing you that a BC is located 9 miles north of the campground and is capable of seating 250 people at one time. It is located in a beautiful pine grove and is open only on Sundays and Wednesdays. I admit it's quite a distance away if you are in the habit of going regularly. But no doubt you will be pleased to know that a great number of people take their lunch along and make a day of it. They usually arrive early and stay late. My daughter met her husband in the BC. The last time my wife and I went, it was so crowded we had to stand up the whole time we were there. Sometimes it is so crowded there are five to a seat. It may interest you to know that right now there is a supper plan to raise money to buy more seats. They are going to hold it in the basement of the BC. It pains me very much not to be able to go more regular, but it's surely not due to lack of desire on my part. As we grow older, it seems to be more of an effort, particularly in cold weather. If you decide to come to our campground, perhaps I could go with you the first time you go and sit with you and introduce you to all the other folks. We will be sure to get a seat up front where you can be seen by everyone. Remember, we are a friendly community. When we think about doing the work of the ministry, sometimes if we're not careful, we can leave the wrong impression by the things that we say and how we say them. So we have to be careful in the work of the ministry that we articulate what we mean and mean what we say. In Luke's Gospel, the 4th chapter, we find a model that Jesus has set for each of us in the ministry. In the 16th verse of the 4th chapter of Luke, Scripture reads, "He came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. As usual, he entered the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up to read. The scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him, and unrolling the scroll, he found the place where it was written, 'The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom to the captives and recover of sight to the blind, to set free the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. He then rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. And the eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fixed on him, and he began by saying to them, "Today, as you listen, this scripture has been fulfilled." They were all speaking well of him and were amazed by the gracious words that came from his mouth. Yet they said, "Isn't this Joseph's son?" Then he said to them, "No doubt you will quote this proverb to me, 'Doctor, heal yourself.' So all we've heard that took place in Capernaum, do here in your hometown also." Jesus finds himself at a homecoming. He goes back home. And when he does that, as his custom was, he went to the synagogue to worship. And having been brought up in that synagogue, they considered it a honor for him to read the scripture, and so they handed it to him to do that. Little knowing what he was going to say and the implications of what he had to say. There are seven imperatives for doing the work of the ministry. Seven imperatives that are so important for each of us that if we miss those, we miss out on doing the kind of work that God would have us to do. I have written a credo of my belief that I want to share. And then I'll preach the next 2 hours after that. That was a tongue-in-cheek statement. Dealing with ministry, I believe that God has called me, first of all, into his family. I've been redeemed by the blood of Jesus, his precious son. I believe my salvation is a continuing process in the sense that I have been saved from my sin and the wages of that sin. I am being saved as I mature in Christ and abide in him, and I will be saved on that great day when I go to be with him for all eternity in heaven. I believe that I have been called into a particular ministry. At this point, it takes the form of pastoral ministry. I've been called to proclaim his word, witness to the lost, and minister to the needs of the fellowship of believers. My highest calling is to walk with him in the light of his word, and then secondly, to do his will in ministry to others. At this point, I believe the church is a setting in which God would have me serve. I feel my responsibility as a pastor to the church is to give spiritual leadership and instruction and to do my best in equipping the fellowship to do what they've been called to do. I view the church as the bride of Christ, and I feel I've been called to be a servant of the church. I feel that the nature of my calling is such that it leaves room for new avenues of service, such as missions, evangelism, or other related work. I, however, felt a very definite call to his service and yielded to his way for my life. So as we look at the church, I believe that the church to be the body of baptized believers who have aligned themselves with the people of like faith and order. A baptized believer is one who has confessed Jesus Christ as his personal Savior and Lord, and ask for forgiveness for sin, acknowledge Jesus as the only begotten Son of God. I feel that the church's mission in the world is to promote the body of Christ, to be a witness to the saving grace and power of Christ, and offer a haven for the sin and sickness of the world. The church as the bride of Christ needs to sense its mission as a real and viable ministry in the world in which we live. I believe the church was meant to be Christ's method of attack against the forces of evil in this world. We become remiss in our responsibility when we negate that privilege of sharing it in the work of the church. Jesus gave himself for the church. And I believe that it is our responsibility to take seriously the task that Jesus has given us in building up the body of Christ. We must quit playing games and come to grips with the reality and truth that Jesus has intended for us, the believer, to be the church, alive and triumphant in this world in which we live. And thirdly, the Christian life. The Christian life, as I have already alluded to earlier, is a daily walk with Christ. I believe that for me to live in Christ is to die to self. I've had to learn what that really means. It's not easy to put aside all the things of the world in order to live for Him. But when they are taken away or destroyed, you suddenly realize that worldly goods don't mean much. That daily fellowship with Christ is a thing that is important and worth keeping. The Christian life involves feeding on His Word daily, walking and talking with Him. A fellowship with Jesus that is abiding. I've mentioned that upon conversion, the Holy Spirit takes residence in your life. The Christian life is the nurturing of daily growth in the Spirit and allowing the Holy Spirit to mature into a right relationship with Him. The prospects of following Christ means I am willing for His will to be done in my life, regardless of the cost or consequences. I've come to see that there's no middle of the road. That the Christian life demands an abiding relationship with Him. Christ either abides in us or He doesn't. He affects our business life, recreation life, social life, and any other aspect of the normal environment we find ourselves in. Salvation. I believe my salvation experience began when I was 8 years old. Upon my conversion experience, the Holy Spirit came into my life and took up residence there. And since then, my salvation experience has continued as I have grown in Christ. I believe I am kept in the palm of the hand of Christ, which is expressed in by abiding in Him and He in me. The fruit of this experience is actualized in my relation to others and expressed in my life as indicated in the New Testament in Galatians 5:22 through 26. Sometimes I'm up and sometimes I'm down, but He is always there to carry me, if need be, when the load gets too heavy for me to carry. I simply have to be willing to let Him. I believe that salvation involves the whole person and the redemption of that person. Christ's redemption is offered as a free gift to all who accept Jesus Christ as Lord. Salvation is a process of having been saved, being saved, and will be saved. Salvation includes regeneration, sanctification, and glorification. We think about the Trinity. I believe in the New Testament concept of the Trinity, to which God manifests Himself to mankind as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I believe there's only one true and living God, that He is infallible, omnipotent, omnipresent, all-powerful, and all-loving. He is creator of the universe and all within it. He is the keeper and sustainer of our faith. I believe He manifests Himself to us as Father, in that He loves us beyond anything we deserve. He provides for us and cares for us. He treats us as a father would treat his child. He also manifests Himself to us as the Son of God. I believe Jesus Christ to be God's only Son, who gave Himself as a ransom for my sin and the sin of the world. He was conceived of the Holy Spirit of a Virgin Mary. He lived on earth, was crucified, buried, and resurrected, and is alive in the hearts and lives of all believers today. God manifests Himself in the Holy Spirit, which is the inspiration for Scripture and helps man to understand the truth of His Word. The Holy Spirit resides in the life of the believer, and it is this force that moves the believer to follow the will of God in daily living. It is from the Holy Spirit that the believer receives His power for Christian service. The Holy Spirit convicts me, and He convicts men of sin, righteousness, and judgment. What about creation? I believe and have no problem whatsoever with the creation account as recorded in the Bible. The Genesis account I believe to be the inspired word as much as any other part of the Bible. I believe that God has the power and ability to do what is recorded in his word. Though the Big Bang Theory and evolution are popular in some circles, I will stick with the word of God as my theology of creation. I can't give all the answers, but I can accept by faith the word of God and leave it with that. My personal pilgrimage. At the age of 8, I made a personal commitment to Christ in which I gave my heart and life to Jesus, accepting him as my personal Savior. And I asked forgiveness for my sin. My school years through high school were in days in which I was under the influence of my parents. I went to church and was active there. But my daily life was not one that exemplified Christ. In college, I rededicated my life to Christ, and after marriage and a stay in the service, I began pastoring a small rural church. My early ministry was modeled after what I saw and heard from others. I was sure I couldn't lose my salvation and try to do ministry my way. All was well and good, except that I was trying to do all the right things for the wrong reasons and motives. And then my time in the seminary helped me to see that ministry is a dependency upon the Lord. Salvation is a process relationship that only starts at conversion. Christ and I walk together in an abiding relationship with him as my helmsman and me as the servant. I believe that now I have a better understanding of how to minister, which has grown out of a maturing relationship with the Lord Jesus. That has come about because of a desire to work through things and a challenge of value systems that before had merely been presuppositions. I now believe that my ministry is an extension of the hand of God. He is working in the world to redeem himself, to redeem mankind to himself in a loving way rather than me. I am no longer doing my thing by forcing men to do what I want them to do. And oh, what joy I find in the difference. My life verse is taken from Joshua, the 24th chapter, 14 and 15. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. That being said, doing the work of the ministry is a joint effort with the leadership and the body of Christ. We talked about that personal calling in the beginning. In Isaiah, we find a passage of scripture that brings about the reality of that calling as it brought it out to Isaiah, should to us in the 6th chapter. Woe is me, for I am ruined, because I am a man of unclean lips and live among a people of unclean lips. And because my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. I think I started down a little further than what's on the board. Let's back up. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated high upon high and lofty throne, and his robe filled the temple. Seraphims were standing above him. Each one had 6 wings. With 2 he covered his face. With 2 he covered his feet. With 2 he flew. And one called to another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. His glory filled the whole earth." The foundations of the doorways shook at the sound of their voices, and the temple was filled with smoke. Then I said, "Woe is me, for I'm ruined, because I'm a man of unclean lips and live among people of unclean lips, and because my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphims flew to me, and in his hand was a glowing coal that he had taken from the altar with tongs. He touched my mouth with it and said, "Now that this has touched your lips, your wickedness is removed and your sin is atoned for." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Who shall I send? Who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I, send me." That is the beginning of ministry. That is the beginning of the work of the ministry. Recognizing the personal calling that God has given to you and I. You see, we don't have to be a preacher or a teacher to be working in the ministry that God has for each and every one of us. Because he has a plan for you. He has something for each and every one of us to do. Some of us may never get up before a crowd and speak. But God still has a plan for you. Has something for you to do. He has a personal calling. He has a ministry work for you to be involved in. Are you willing to accept that call? Are you willing to say, here am I, send me? Then there's the church. Not talking about the church building. I'm talking about the church. The church is the body of Christ. That's you and I. Working together, serving together, striving to do the things that God would have us to do. You and I are the body of Christ. In 2 Chronicles, the 29th chapter, we find a passage of scripture where Hezekiah was a king, and he had torn down the idols and the high places, and he had reestablished the temple worship, and now he calls the church together. And here in the 27th verse of chapter 29, 2 Chronicles, then Hezekiah ordered that the burnt offering be offered on the altar. And when the burnt offering began, the song of the Lord and the trumpets began, accompanied by the instruments of David, king of Israel. The whole assembly was worshiping, singing the songs and blowing the trumpets, and all of this continued until the burnt offering was complete. And when the burnt offering was completed, the king and all those present with him bowed down and worshiped. And then King Hezekiah and the officials told the Levites to sing praise to the Lord. And in the words of David and of Asaph, the seer, so they sang praises with rejoicing and bowed down and worshiped. You see, the church, the body of Christ, when we come together, we're to worship. We're to sing praises. We're to lift our voices up in praise and adoration to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. For he is King and he is Lord. Stories told about John Ed tells a story. He went down to the YMCA on Friday night recently with his family to go swimming. He said, I was sitting on the edge of the pool watching the kids swim when I noticed a little fellow about 5 years old entered the pool area. He was ready to swim. He had on a fancy bathing suit. He had swim fins on, a diving mask, a snorkel tube, and I don't know what else. He looked like he had as much equipment as a professional scuba diver. Well, the little fellow sat on the side of the pool. He watched everybody swim. He never got in the water, he just kicked a little with his feet. He had all the necessary equipment at his disposal for an exciting swim, but he was contented to dangle his feet in the water. I saw myself and the church in that little fellow. God has placed at our disposal all the necessary ingredients for life to be an exciting adventure. The church is standing on the threshold of her finest hour. God is calling us to launch out into new and creative roles of witness and service. God wants us to experience a fun in the faith that is like a refreshing swim. But too often we're just content to sit on the side and watch. I wondered when the little fellow would get up the courage to get in the pool and use what he had. He will sometime, and what fun he will have. And the same is true for all of us, if we simply get off the side and get in the pool. But let me say to you, if there's ever been a time in the history of the church, now is the time for the church to be the church. with what's going on in our nation and in the world around us, I shudder to think of some of the things that we're going to see and may have to endure. But it's time for the church to be the church. Quit playing and be real. Be ministering in the world in which we live. Let others see Jesus in you and I. We look at the Christian life. What is the Christian life? That third imperative is that of a daily walk with Him. We need to start out our day walking with Jesus. We need to close our day walking with Jesus. I can start out good. I've done that a lot in life. I start out well. I used to run track. I used to be a miler. It's probably hard for you to realize. It's hard for me to realize now. But running that mile was a pretty arduous task, but it really wasn't all that bad once you got in shape and got used to it. The kicker come is when you had competition and had to outrun your opponent. I went to a track meet at Clinton, Missouri one time and decided that I was going to beat their best because he had the conference title. Well, I didn't decide enough, I guess, because I didn't beat him. Started out good. I determined that I was going to stay right with him. And I knew if I could stay right with him, I could have enough kick at the end to pass him up. So we took off. And I stayed right with him to the first corner. And when we started around that first corner, the wind was blowing pretty hard, and it just hit me like a brick wall. And he pulled away, and I could not keep up. My intentions were great, but I did not have what it took to stay the course to win the race. I am so thankful that as a Christian, I do not have to depend upon myself. I do not have to depend upon my own strength, but I have the power of the Holy Spirit in which to draw upon. And when I'm running the race of life, all I have to do is call upon my Savior and my Lord to give me the strength that I need to stay the course. That is living the Christian life. Salvation. Well, as we think about the Christian life, I did want to share a scripture. Psalms 119:11 says, "Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against you." Do we hide the word of God in our heart? Do we know that we know that we know that God Word is living in us? Do we read His word enough that we can draw upon the strength that's there when trouble comes? When I was a young lad, we moved to Warrensburg, Missouri, and we joined a Baptist church there, and they right away got me involved in the boys' organization, which was called Royal Ambassadors. And one of the things that we had to do was memorize scripture. And to this day, I remember most of those scriptures that I memorized. However, I guess there's something wrong with my brain because the older I got, the harder it was to memorize scripture. And so I have to repeatedly go back to God's word and study and reread and rememorize His word. But He promises that when we need it, it'll be there for us to draw upon. Salvation, a personal relationship. Galatians, the 5th chapter. Verses 22 and following. But the fruit of the Spirit is love. We could camp out on that for a little while. And you know what's coming next. What's love got to do with it? Sometimes we say that so often we don't really catch the meaning, or it doesn't sink very deep in our souls. But the world in which we're living in today tests our ability to love. I know it tests mine. I don't know about you. I have a hard time loving people that's going against our Constitution. I have a hard time loving people that despitefully use us, that talk down on Christian folk, et cetera, et cetera. But Jesus says to love our enemies. When we can get a handle on loving one another and loving our enemies, we're on the road. We're where God wants us to be in being able to relate to other people. The fruit of the Spirit is love. And when we have love, there's joy. And when we have joy, there's peace. And when we have peace, there's patience. And when we have patience, there's kindness and goodness and faith. There's gentleness and there's self-control. Against such, there is no law. You see, this is a progression that Jesus planned for us to understand and get a hold of. And as Paul is sharing this with the church at Galatia, he's saying that we need first to love, and when we do, these others will fall into place. And since we live by the Spirit, we must also follow the Spirit. Wow. Follow the Holy Spirit. Personal relationship. That's what salvation is about. But you see, we can have a personal relationship with Christ and still sit on the side of the pool. Do you know that? Some folks get saved for fire insurance purposes. They don't want to get too involved. Might have to do something that they really don't want to do. Might have to go someplace they really didn't want to go. It's kind of interesting to me, and even as I say this, I recognize in my own life that I've been there. If God sent his son Jesus to die on a cross for me, which he did, shed his blood for my life, which he did, paid the price for my sin, which he did, why should not I be willing and wanting to do whatever it is that God would have me to do, knowing full well that he will bless me beyond all measure? Actualize our personal relationship with Jesus Christ. What does that mean? That means simply sharing with somebody else what's happened in your heart and in your life. We come to that fifth imperative about the Trinity. Well, some folks want to believe part of that, not all of it. because they don't understand it, they don't want to believe it. But God manifested himself to man in three ways. In Matthew 28, 19 and 20, he simply said, as you go into the world, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And the King James says, and lo, I'll be with you always to the end of the world. There in that commission that Jesus gave, we see the authority of the Trinity, the three personalities of God, the manifestation of God in three ways. And the Holy Spirit is that manifestation that works in the hearts and the lives of God's people who are willing and ready to do the work of the ministry. And if the power of the Holy Spirit is working in us, there is no other power that can overcome that. We simply put our faith and our trust in him. So why should we fear? Why should we worry when it comes to sharing the gospel with somebody else? Someone says, well, I'm afraid to go and tell somebody. I'm afraid I'll fail, or afraid I won't say the right words. When we're faithful to do the bidding that God has asked us to do, it doesn't matter how we stumble, it doesn't matter how we get the words out, God will use that and honor that. And then creation. God, the master builder. My father was a master carpenter. And in his older years, he liked to whittle. And he would take a block of wood and he would begin to whittle on it. And then all of a sudden, something would appear that he was working on. And someone asked him one day, How do you carve out that mule or that horse or that pair of pliers? How do you know what to cut away? And he simply said, just cut away what you don't want. Cut away what's not the horse or what's not the mule or what's not the pliers. The Bible says in Genesis 1:1, and I believe what Genesis 1:1 says, in the beginning, God created. That's good enough for me. He created. He created each and every one of us here today. And he gave us an opportunity to follow suit in doing the things that he would have us to do in being and doing the work of the ministry. And so when he created the world, and he created you and I, he created us for a purpose. Or else you wouldn't be here. You know that? If God didn't have a plan for your life, you wouldn't be here. He had something for you to do. Something for me to do. Does that mean we always do it? No. Sometimes we're a long time getting around to doing the things that God wants us to do. But if we ever come to a point in our life when we give all of our hearts and all of our life and all of our soul to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, then God can use us to his purpose. He can cause us to bloom where we're planted. The last imperative, personal pilgrimage. Your testimony. Your testimony must begin with salvation. Otherwise, you don't have one. What's it mean to have a testimony? To have a testimony, you are a witness to what happens in your life. You really don't have a viable testimony until you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, because that's the only thing that really means anything. And so your testimony begins when you acknowledge Him as Lord and Him as Savior. Then you have an opportunity to adopt, if you will, a life's verse. When you accept Him as Lord and Savior and you recognize that He has a purpose for you and for your life, then that purpose will be actualized in God's Word as He shows you your purpose through His Word. Your life's verse may not be my life's verse, but God has a plan for every creation, and He has a word for you. Something for you to do, something for me to do. Beloved, let me assure you, today is the day to do it. We're not going to have second chances. And you and I need to be real in our relationship to ministry. The work of the ministry, doing the work of the ministry, what does that really mean? You know, we spend a lot of time, Bible studies, going to church, small groups, all these kinds of things, and these are all good. But what goods are they if we don't tell somebody about Jesus and lead some soul to Him? Let me challenge each and every one of us to do just that. Find someone that's hurting. Find someone that needs Jesus and share with them your life verse. Share with them your testimony. Let them know whose you are, so that they may find out who they are. Now hear me. The majority of the world that you and I live in today, people do not know who they are. That's why we're in the mess we're in. But when they find out whose they are, they find out who they are, oh, what a difference it makes, and what a life change there will be. And you and I have the key to sharing the gospel by simply going out and being faithful to do that thing that God has purposed for our life day by day. Pray with me. Our Heavenly Father, as we come today, our hearts are heavy because of what we see going on in our world today. Our hearts are heavy because of what's going on in our nation. Some of our hearts are heavy because of what's going on in our families. But Father, we know that You are in charge. We know that You have purposed for each and every one of us as Christians to be a catalyst, to be a blessing to someone else. It is our prayer, Heavenly Father, that as we leave this place tonight, that we might be all that you would have us to be, that we would purpose in our heart and in our life to be a catalyst to bring somebody else to a saving knowledge of Jesus. That the world seen, that our nation seen, that our family seen might be changed. Why? Because in the beginning, you created us for a purpose. And that purpose was to love you and then to love one another. And only, Father, if we love one another, show the world that we really care, will there be a change. And there can be a difference. Thank you, Lord, for speaking to us and through us this day. May the words of our mouths and the meditations of our heart continue to be acceptable in your sight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Mm-hmm.